And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me
for the pay cut.
But I'm gonna be looking at you from the face down. My Mac 11 need the room with the bass down. Scheming.
Chapter 4 of the Kendrick Lamar journey.
We fucking here. Look inside these walls and you see them having withdrawals of a prisoner on his way. Check inside your desire to find your bullets that stray. Check a tire just tell.
Alright, man. We fucking here, bro. I ain't gonna make the intro too long because let's be real, bro. This is gonna be a long video. So I'm trying to get straight into it. Welcome, man. Welcome to chapter 4 of the Kendrick Lamar journey. We have already reacted to Overly Dedicated, Section 80, Good Kid, Mad City, as well as the deluxe. All reactions, full reactions with timestamps are on my Kendrick Lamar playlist. You can go to the playlist tab, find the Kendrick Lamar playlist. Everything is there. You feel me? As well as some additional Kendrick Lamar reactions from The Beef and other tracks that he's released previously. We here though. This is a big reaction, man. I don't think I've reacted to an album with as much lore and as much presence as this, like, since Illmatic. I think Illmatic might be the only album that can stand in the same category or same caliber as this album. So, it's a big one, man. It's a big one, but we here nonetheless. I'm gonna let y'all know now. I have never listened to this album in its entirety. So a lot of these songs I actually haven't heard at all. I've only heard like the big songs, the notable songs like Wesley's Theory. I've heard that one. I think I've heard For Free, actually. I think I might have seen a video of it. King Kunta, of course. All Right, of course. Yeah, I don't think I've heard any of the other tracks. Because this album came out before I actually got into Kendrick. Like, I think I really invested myself into listening to Kendrick. I could probably say from Damn. Because, yeah, man. Damn was probably the first album I listened to entirely through. And from there, I knew more about Kendrick and what his substance is about. Also, this album was just, bro, this album, even still today, this is a very, very complex album. Like, I need y'all to understand how advanced Kendrick's work is. Like, the last three albums I reacted to, the easiest reaction out of all of those was by far Overly Dedicated. And then when we got into Section 80 and Good Kid, Mad City, bro, my head was fucking spinning by the end of those videos. Like, those shits is, bro, the footage you see is maybe just over half the footage I record. Like, those videos, I be really diving into them. And I'm pretty sure this album is heavier in terms of content than all of his albums he's ever released. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe so. So, I'm sure there will be a million things that I don't catch. Because, I mean, for a lot of these tracks, like I mentioned, it's going to be my first reaction. So, y'all got to drop in the comments. Y'all got to drop in the comments below anything I don't catch or any alternative meanings to certain lines that I might break down. If y'all know alternative meanings to them. Yeah, I mean, shit, bro. We could get started with the fucking cover art. I mean, okay, let's get into the track list first. And then we go move into the cover art. So, track list, we got 16 tracks. From Wesley's Theory all the way to Mortal Man. And I do know, I don't know exactly word for word what he says, but I do know in Mortal Man, he expands a little bit on where how he came up with the title, To Pimp a Butterfly. So I'm curious to see what his explanation is for that, because I've always wondered what that meant, To Pimp a Butterfly. In terms of features, you got George Clinton and Thundercat on track one, Wesley's Theory. You got Anna Wise, Bilal, and Snoop Dogg on track four. You got Anna Wise and Bilal again, as well as Thundercat on track 5. I've noticed he's had Anna Wise on his albums for a while. He's really tight with her. I'm pretty sure he's been featuring Anna Wise on his project since Overly Dedicated. I don't think he's had a project without her. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I know he's clearly tight with her, for sure. You got James Fauntleroy. Apologies if I butchered that. James Fauntleroy and Ronald Isley on track 11, How Much a Dollar Costs. Rhapsody on track 12, which is Complexion. And that's it. I mean, brief. Pretty simple with the features. In terms of the album art, now, this artwork is fucking complex as hell. Like, When you look at the art, you just see, you see the group of people, you see them in front of the White House, which I'll be honest, until like I started looking into it for real, I didn't really even realize that the White House was the building in the back. I just kind of seen it like the group of people in front of a building, and that's just what it was. But they're in front of the White House. You see Kendrick in the middle of all of his people. I'd assume these are people from his hood. And notice at the bottom, you see the dead judge. And I'm going to actually get into that because I feel like based on what we see in the artwork, and I'll expand more on it, of course, but based on what we see in the artwork and some of the titles of the tracks, I'm assuming Kendrick is going to be kind of on his Nas shit in the sense of like, similarly to how Nas is always, throughout all of his albums, he's always had certain tracks where he's trying to talk to the government or trying to speak to the elites or trying to speak to the higher powers about how they're treating minority groups or how they're treating African Americans in certain hoods. Pretty much the system is unjust or the system is unfair, how they automatically assume them to be up to no good, how they automatically assume them to be associated to certain crimes, you know, and just, you know, racially motivated behavior. And I feel like Kendrick is going to be going for the same thing on this album. Like, I mean, shit, we can see you got a track called one of the biggest tracks on the album is called King Kunta. And I'm pretty certain that's about Kunta Kinte, the main character from Roots. I've never watched the movie, but I know the movie is like, it has a lot of themes of slavery and Kunta Kinte being the main character. I'm assuming he was a slave who went through certain things in that movie. Like I said, you have Kendrick and his hood, and they're standing in front of the White House, which is known to be the building that hosts the most powerful man in the country, the president. They're standing over a dead judge. And I actually read on the Genius page that discusses the cover art, Kendrick himself said on a 2015, April 2015 Mass Appeal interview, I quote, he mentions here, he says, "You look at these individuals and you look at them as bad people or a menace to society. This is not just what the higher powers view. This is what certain even just civilians that are not of color view these people as bad people. Like I mentioned before, how they're quickly associated to crime, they're quickly associated to wrongdoing, they're quickly associated to injustice. You look at these individuals and you see them as bad people or a menace to society, but they're actually good people. They're just a product of their environment. And one person that always represents their night lives negatively is the judge, assuming them to be in the wrong when the situation isn't actually as bad." And the thing is, not everyone who is raised in the hood partakes in these particular activities at all. Kendrick being a perfect example. I mean, Kendrick mentioned it. I remember on Good Kid, Mad City, he had the one song where he was talking about, I forgot what the song was, but he had the line in the song where he was saying something about when he's in a certain spots of his hood and he's facing against opposite gangs, "They foot on my neck, Nike," something about Nike checks. And then he followed the second verse by making that verse about police and how the police view him as a black man. And then he said the same line about "their foot on my neck, same weight as the bulletproof vest," or something like that. It's just like, Kendrick wasn't actually partaking in those activities per se. He actually wasn't doing any wrong per se at all. But the people view him, or the police and others view him as that type of person due to the color of his skin. "Only God can judge these individuals right here. Not no one with a gavel handing out football numbers of years and not giving these kids a chance at life." Pretty much saying that only God can judge them and no one is above God to say what they are and what they aren't. Which I assume is why the judge is there in the position he's in. And also why I assume they're celebrating in front of the White House, because even the rich elites, the ones who have the power, the ones who claim that the minority groups are the ones causing the problems, they're still going to dance and laugh in front of you because they know that what you're saying doesn't mean anything. What you're saying is purely, it's racially motivated. It doesn't actually have any substance or any factual backing behind what they're actually saying. I'm not gonna delve into this because I don't wanna misquote it, but I remember reading on that same article I saw, there are actually a few women in this picture, but the women are all either covered up completely or they're like barely visible. And I remember there is some sort of men over women political theme there, but I don't want to dive into it because I don't remember exactly what it is and I don't want to misquote it. But yeah, man, I'm sure there's a whole bunch of themes I'm not catching. Like, I was assuming that maybe even the black and white, the album cover being in black and white was meant to be reminiscent to a time when black people were treated a lot more unfairly. If there's anything I'm not catching or there's anything I misinterpreted, please let me know in the comments where I'm wrong or what I didn't catch. I'm sure there must be something to go with the money and the alcohol as well, like everyone holding money and alcohol. I don't know if it's just like a hood theme or if there's a deeper meaning. I mean, it's Kendrick. There's probably a deeper meaning to every small thing. But yeah, y'all let me know in the comments below. Without further ado, I'm not gonna waste no time. I'm expecting this to be a real preachy album from Kendrick, a real speak for his people type of album. I mean, I could definitely see why this resonates with a lot of people in hip hop, given that hip hop itself is a black sport. But yeah, let's get into it, bro. Let's get into it. Track one is called Wesley's Theory, featuring George Clinton and Thundercat. Hold on, already here. When the four corners of this cocoon collide, you'll slip through the cracks hoping that you'll survive. Wait, okay. Is he making... Just because of the way that he said you'll slip through the cracks hoping that you'll survive, I'm instantly thinking, is he making like a reference to the hood? Okay, yeah. It says something here. When the artist breaks out, quote unquote, breaks out of the proverbial cocoon or the ghetto, their journey begins as a butterfly. Oh. So it's like what they are or the product. Oh, maybe he's talking about the views. Maybe he's talking about like... That's why the judge is there. Maybe he's talking about the way that they're viewed, like the people who are raised in the hood. He mentioned, like I said, the little monologue that Kendrick had in that Mass Appeal interview. He mentioned how the people in the hood are not as bad as people view them to be. Because they're in the hood, they're viewed that way. And that's not something that they can really do anything about. But they're not as bad as it seems. So maybe he's talking about that because it's like, I'm just trying to think, like, to pimp a butterfly, he mentioned a cocoon. So, like, you had a larva, goes into a cocoon, then comes out a butterfly. So is he talking about, like, maybe while they're in the hood, they're viewed as something negative or they're viewed as something ugly, I guess, or something that's not as appealing, like a larva or a caterpillar. People think that the little crawly guy is disgusting. Then once they escape out the cocoon, they emerge a butterfly. And once they're out the hood... I don't know. I don't want to dive like too deep into it right away, but maybe it's a way that Kendrick is even reflecting himself, being who he was in the hood, how he was treated until he came out as a rapper, emerged as a star, as a butterfly. And now people view him in a whole different light. They don't even really acknowledge him as the same way that they would someone else in the hood. They look at him like a star. Even the people in power like have praise for him. For who he is. Hold on. At first I did love you. Right. But I just wanna fuck you. Yeah. Late nights thinking of you. Until I get my life tossed and turned. Listen, learn. You was my first girlfriend. Riches burn. Our car. This track's got a real West Coast feel, bro. It sounds like something that Dr. Dre produced. Did he produce it? Wait, hold on. Let's see. Oh, no. He didn't produce it. It doesn't have him, his name on the credits, but it sounds like something that he would have produced. He said, I'm going to put the Compton swap meet by the White House. Republic run up, get socked out. That's literally what you see in the cover art. You see Kendrick with his guys in front of the White House. And then the Republican, I mean, or the judge at least, is knocked out. He's got X's on his eyes and everything. Get knocked out. Know what, now that I'm thinking about it, that might be what the money is for. Like, I didn't know what everyone holding the money, what the symbolism is of that. But maybe it could be just as simple as if they weren't holding the money, you would look at them a certain way, in a certain light. But with them holding a stack of bread each, you look at them differently. Like, okay, shit, this guy's getting money. This guy, maybe he's not as bad as I think he is. Maybe that's the purpose. Maybe that's the purpose of them holding the money. I'm thinking that, but then it could also just be a thing of like, they made the money through drug dealing, so doesn't really change the light. But like, I did love you, shit, but now I just want to fuck. Late nights thinking of you. Oh shit, there you go. Dr. Dre. Everything you buy, taxes will deny. That's real shit right there. What? I'll Wesley snipe your ass before 35. Oh shit. Okay, Wesley Snipes is well known for serving time due to tax evasion. Oh wow, that's crazy. Wesley snipe your ass, like I'ma get your ass down, like snipe your ass, playing off of his name. But he also got done for tax evasion, so playing off the last line too of everything you buy, taxes will deny. Damn. Come on, talk, bro. Both ways before you cross my mind, playing off of look both ways before you cross the road. But it said that the sound actually pans across the speakers. Hold on. Let's see if I can hear that. Oh shit, word, it does. That's wow, that's crazy. So he said look both ways before you cross your mind. I was actually supposed to try to see what the bar is. I think maybe it's a thing of just like before you come into my mind talking about like an op. But yeah, the audio actually goes across the speakers. That's crazy. That's really creative. Like before you cross my mind, and then obviously that, because you're listening to this shit on headphones or on speakers usually, and the device is going to be in your ear, so the sound is going to be going in your ear, so it's going to literally feel like the sound is crossing your mind. Damn, this man played this shit in 4K, bro, in 4D. What the fuck? Wesley's theory is pretty much going around the whole theme of tax evasion and how Wesley Snipes got cut up for tax evasion. Kendrick was pretty much playing on that. I mean, Kendrick was really talking about how he's gonna blow his money after he gets signed, like all the little material shit, irresponsible shit that he could purchase. He said on the first verse he's uneducated but got $1 million check like that. Obviously he didn't get the money going through school and getting a professional job. You got the money through rapping, which doesn't necessarily require any academic education. So then he gets into that in the second verse, talking about all the shit that he's gonna spend his money on because that's what he knows, because that's what he grew up around, seeing people with the Ferraris and the chains and all the other shit, you know, the nice spots, VIP spots in the clubs and shit. And then the last four lines of that second verse, he says, and when you hit the White House, do you? But remember, you ain't passed economics in school. You don't know about how the taxes work. You don't know how the inflation works. You don't know about all the different markets and stocks and how that's just going to affect your money. Like, how that's just going to affect how things cost and shit. Everything you buy, taxes will deny, but you're not going to catch on to that part because you just worry about how to spend the money. I'll Wesley snipe your ass before 35. All right, track two is called For Free, interlude. I'm pretty sure this is that song, This Dick Ain't Free. Hold on, let's see. She said, walking around like you God's gift to earth. Imagine being so full of yourself that you think God looked at earth and said, you know what? I'm going to gift you this particular human being. This person is special. This one is different than all the rest. Acting full of yourself. That's crazy. God's gift to earth. God damn. He said, living in captivity, raise my cap celery, playing off the celery, telling me green is all I need, money is all I need, but the celery, evidently all I seen was spam and raw sardines. I mean, baby, you really think with a mega baby name Mercedes, well, I'm Mercedes Benz, a 24-inch rims, 5% deep, the air conditioning vents. Hell fucking no, this dick ain't free. I need 40 acres in a mule, not a 40 ounce in a pit pool, bullshit. Matador, knocking, let him make it. Woo! He said, I need 40 acres in a mule, not a 40 ounce in a pit bull. Playing off a pit bull, he says, bullshit. Matador, and a matador is a person who rides the bulls. in those Stampede events. So, Matador knocking in, let him in. Bro, this guy's chatting, bro. Like, he's literally talking to you. He's not even really rapping, for real. But he is, though. Like, he's rapping through casual speech. That's crazy. Oh wow, okay, so the girl is America, pretty much. I guess the first track was speaking on the whole thing of like having to pay the taxes and shit. Like, I made this money and now I gotta give half of this shit to taxes, but you don't even get to really enjoy the shit that you pay for. You don't even get enjoy the shit that you earn. You don't get to go and spend it, which is what I think he was getting in with Wesley's theory. Like, of course, hey, shit, man, if I can evade my taxes and keep my money, I'm gonna evade my taxes. I'm gonna do this shit until I get caught. Fuck it. Wesley's theory, right? And then that transitions into this track where I guess Kendrick is responding to that. Like, I think the first track was pretty much like, y'all think you can spend this money? Fuck you. Hit y'all with taxes. And then this track is pretty much Kendrick like rebuttaling that, saying like, yo, you can't. Yeah, bro, this dick ain't free, bitch. Talking to America. Like, yeah, fuck you, bro. I'm doing what I will with my money, bro. He ends the track by saying, oh, America, you bad bitch. I picked cut and made you rich. Now my dick ain't free. you got the money. You got the money because of me. Y'all, you is the country that you is because of me. Or me or my people. And now you gonna tell me to give you even more money? Man, fuck you, bro. This dick ain't free, bitch. All right, track 3, King Kunta. Let's go. I got a bone to pick. Legendary track right here. I don't want you monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again. I'm mad, but I ain't stressing. True friends. One question, yes. Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run again, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off.
Bitch, where you and I? the time you hear the next pop, the folk shall be within you.
Now I run again, got the whole world talking. King Kofi, everybody wanna cut the legs off. King Kofi, black man taking no less. Oh, yeah. Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run again, got the whole world talking. King Kofi, everybody wanna cut the legs off.
Misusing your influence.
So yeah, so King Kunta, everybody want to cut the legs off him, is referring to Kunta had his foot cut off to prevent him from escaping the plantation. I believe that's referring to Kunta Kinte from the movie. So you're just making a callback to that. Oh, and then with the title King Kunta, it says here that King Kunta is actually an oxymoron, stating that Kendrick is simultaneously oppressed as a slave and dominant like a king. And I feel like that probably does tie into the theme, if I'm correct. I think I'm onto something, bro. Because a lot of these lines that I'm seeing, they make sense with what my assumption was in terms of the whole thing of, it's because of that line he mentioned in the first song in Wesley's Theory about you're in the four corners of the cocoon. And I just imagine that the cocoon is referring to the hood, because it's like, it's an entrapment. It's like a barred up area, not literally, but figuratively is barred up. It's an area that's not designed for them to escape from, or it's designed for minority groups to get out of. And then he mentioned in the second line right after, like, will you be lucky enough to escape through the cracks and emerge as a butterfly? And I feel like I'm right about that, just because of what he's talking about here. Like, again, he talks about, like I mentioned, King Kunta being him oppressed as a slave, yet dominant like a king. And him saying that makes you think, like, you can look at it, you can view him or just anyone in his position, any black man in his position, in those two lights. I was literally thinking about this too, like, Kendrick, he has a tendency, I think with every single album, he's always had that double theme. Like with Overly Dedicated, you had OD, which leaned towards drugs and overdose, but OD as in overly dedicated and him being dedicated to his pen. So there was two ways that you can view and then view every single track that he made. With Section 80, he had that sinfulness versus the righteousness. I don't exactly recall the theme in Good Kid, M.A.A.D. City. It was something like innocence versus wrongdoing. It was something like that. But my point is, there was always some sort of a double theme. And I think this is what the double theme is in this album. I think it's the light in which you view a black person. You can view them as the caterpillar, or as the ugly caterpillar, or the person that that everyone outside the hood views the people inside the hood, automatically assuming them to be in the wrong, automatically assuming them to be associated to crime, automatically assuming them to be immoral. You know what I'm saying? Or you can view them as the butterfly. When they escape the hood and they actually make the money and come out, whether as an athlete or as a rapper or as any other position, even just as a normal professional job, or, you know, when they come out in a white collar position. He mentioned it in one of his other songs too, like the white lies, white collar. Yeah, bro. I feel like that might be what the theme is, bro. I think it's just, depending on their status in life or whether they're inside or outside the hood is like kind of the determining factor of how they're viewed. And I feel like that's what Kendrick is tapping into, because that would make perfect sense with what he's saying here with King Kunta, where, you know, there's the king portion, which is like, you know, dominant like a king. He's up. He's on top of the game at this point. I'm pretty sure we went over this before, but when he released Section 80, I think he was barely selling like 10K records. And then when he dropped Good Kid, M.A.A.D. City, now he's selling like over 200K. He's doing shows. At this point, when he was actually still cool with Drake, he's touring with Drake and shit. Like, bro, and it's like Kendrick's in a whole different platform at this point. And then especially after releasing Good Kid, M.A.A.D. City, it's like, bro, now we're viewing him like a superstar. And then he drops this album right here. So it's like, you can either view him as as Kendrick Lamar, or the Kendrick Lamar we know as like the rapper, or you can view him as Kendrick Lamar as what he was before the rap. And the perspective that people would have on him is completely different depending on which light you view him in. And I think that's really what he's going for. I think that's really what he's going for with the entirety of this album. I think that might be the double theme. Bro, this shit is crazy, bro. When you actually sit back and look at this shit, like, man, every album has a double theme. That's crazy. Every single Kendrick Lamar album can be viewed in two different lights. And it's up to you to determine what those two lights are over multiple listens of the album. That is crazy, bro. All right, let's get into this, man. Track 4 is called Institutionalized. Let's go.
What money got to do with it? When I don't know the full definition of a rap image. I'm trapped inside the ghetto and I ain't proud to admit it. Institutionalized, I keep running back for a visit. Hold up. Get it back. I said I'm trapped inside the ghetto and I ain't proud to admit it. Institutionalized, I can still kill me a nigga, so what?
If I was the president,
okay, oh my god, bro. I'm so glad I caught what I caught, because now this shit is fucking fire, bro. Because now I get it. Like, King Kunta, okay, I think this is the second perspective of the light. So I think in King Kunta, although he was mentioning the two lights a little bit in King Kunta, I feel like the premise of King Kunta was supposed to be the butterfly light. That was supposed to be viewing Kendrick as the butterfly, as the rap superstar. And then this song, Institutionalized, he's talking about how he, no matter how big he gets and how far away he gets from the hood is still enrooted in him, to where he's still going back and making visits. He's still doing certain hood shit with his boys. I think I think King Kunta was intended to be the butterfly light, and this track is intended to be the caterpillar. This track is intended to be the negative light that's painted on. Okay, bro, hold on. Wait, I gotta run this whole shit back now.
When I don't know the full definition of a rap image, I'm trapped inside the ghetto and
I'm proud to admit it. Institutionalized, I keep running back for a visit. Hold up.
Get it back.
I said I'm trapped inside the ghetto and I ain't proud to admit it. Institutionalized,
I can still kill me a nigga.
Right? Still that guy.
If I was the president, I'd pay my mama's rent. Free my homies and them. Bulletproof my Chevy doors, lay in the White House and get higher. Whoever thought, master, take the chains off me. Oh my god, that's crazy. I'm sorry, I gotta go back. He had that one line right there. He said, oh shit, my flow's so sick, don't you swallow it. If you sick, you don't want to swallow your spit because your shit is infected. Biting my style, your salmonella poison positive. Right after just saying his flow is sick, don't... Oh my goodness, bro. Biting my style, your salmonella poison positive.
I can just alleviate the rap industry politics.
Put me through colleges. Follow it, yeah.
Yeah. Truthfully, our love was for you. Usually, you're never charged. But something came over you once I took you to the fucking BET Awards. You're looking at artists like the harvesters. So many roadies around you, and you want all of them. Somebody told me you thinking about snatching jewelry. I should have listened what my grandmama said to me. Shit don't change, dear. Get up and wash your ass, man.
y'all, but this is what they say.
Fuck am I supposed to do when I'm looking at walking legs? The constant big money talk about the mansion in foreign ways. The dropping chest and passport, presidential glass for gold bottles, sniffing up the ass for.
Peep this, bro. The difference between the perspective. Look at this. So Kendrick said in the first verse, he took his boys from the hood. So he's still attached to the hood. We already mentioned this. He's still attached to the hood. He's still visiting. He would, if he had the power that these rich elites do, which, I mean, now he's getting there. But if he had that type of power, shit. If I was the president, I'd lay up in the White House. I'd free my boys. I'd pay my mama's rent. You know? I take care of my hood, you know what I'm saying? He ended that first verse by talking about when he brings his friends. Hold on, let me get the line exactly. But something came over you once I took you to them fucking BET Awards. Now Kendrick is an established rapper. He's probably gone through PR training at this point. He knows how to act, he knows how to behave. So he's approaching the BET Awards like how he's supposed to, right? You know, appropriately. He's approaching that shit as an artist. He's approaching that shit in the light that he's viewed now, the butterfly light. He's got a few of his friends around him who are still viewed in that caterpillar light, who are still trapped in the hood, who haven't come out of it. But something, and then he's talking about them. He's talking about their perspective. Something came over you once I took you to them fucking BET Awards. You're looking at artists like they're harvests. So many rollies around you and you are all of them. Somebody told me you thinking about snatching jewelry. I should have listened to my grandma when she said to me, and then gets into that chorus. Snoop Dogg has his little part where he says, speaking in Kendrick's perspective, he says, he was 5 foot something. God bless the kid. He took his homies to the show and this is what they said. And now we get into verse two, which is the perspective of his homies. But again, it's verse one being the butterfly perspective, whereas verse two is that caterpillar perspective. Inside versus outside the hood, what the perspectives are, how they change. When I'm looking at walking licks, presidential glass for gold bottles, gold models, giving up the ass for Instagram flicks. Fuck is this? One more sucker waving with a fleshy wrist. My defense mechanism tell me to get him quickly because he got it. It's a recession, then what the fuck he ain't keep the diamonds? No more living poor, meet my 4-4. When I see him with the bird damn on the floor, now kick him, know they your co-workers. But it's gonna take a lot for this bitch to go cold turkey. Now I can watch it, watch on the TV and be okay. But see him on the... That's kind of tough too. It's gonna take a lot for this pistol go cold turkey. Like, when something goes cold turkey, or when you quit something cold turkey, you completely stop using it off the jump and just never use it. And usually that's referring to just breaking habit, like automatically breaking habit, which is not something that's easy to do. So I think that could be just referring to that. Like, his homies from the hood is so used to using those guns, using those pistols. It's going to take a while before this pistol go cold turkey, before I just drop it and start acting like how you have learned to act being in the limelight. But also a thing of like, when you shoot the gun is hot. And he's saying, before this pistol go cold turkey, before the barrel cool down, like,
no more living poor, meet my 4-4. When I see him put a per diem on the floor, now can you know that you're co-workers? But it's gonna take a lot for this pistol go cold turkey. Now I can watch it, watch on the TV and be okay. But see him on the clock when that watch landed in LA. Remember still from the rich and giving it back to the
crazy. Now I can watch his watch, first of all. Now I can watch his watch on TV and be okay. But knowing he's got that watch, I'm on the clock when he land in LA. I gotta go get that shit. But the whole thing of watch his watch, I'm on the clock when that watch landing.
Remember still from the rich and giving it back to the poor. Well, that's me at these awards.
I guess my grandmama was warning the boy. She said,
Ooh, and that's tough too. Remember steal from the rich and giving it back to the poor. Recall. In the synopsis, Kendrick mentioned, hey, these boys is in the hood and y'all viewing them in a bad light, but they actually good people. They don't deserve to be judged by these elite powers. They only deserve to be judged by God. I think that's this line right here is representative of that perspective. Him saying, remember, steal from the rich and giving it back to the poor. He actually has good intentions on what he wants to do with it. Just the action that he's doing to receive the riches or receive what he wants to give back to the poor. That's the good action. is not something necessarily to be viewed as bad. What's viewed as bad is the action of stealing from the rich. And the people who are rich or the people who are in power are only going to remember this person for the fact that he stole. So, yeah, bro. Oh, my God. This is crazy. Once upon a time in the city something fine called Westside Compton, there stood a little nigga, he was 5 foot something. They stay confused, talented, but still under the name of unclothed. You can take the boy out the hood, but you can't take the hood off the homie. Took his show money, standing in the Mosey Mosey. Hollywood's nervous. Fuck you, good night, thank you much for your service. King Kunta and Institutionalized were the first tracks that really, like, broke down those two lights, the butterfly light versus the caterpillar light. And yeah, let's go further into it, man. The next track is called, track five is called These Walls. So maybe that's gonna be like the in between. We had the butterfly and King Kunta, we had the caterpillar and Institutionalized, and maybe the cocoon now is gonna be These Walls. Track five, let's see.
I remember you was conflicted. Misusing your influence.
Right.
Sometimes I did the same.
Second, okay, I had a feeling just from how the song intros. So I'm reading the lyrics off of Genius, if you're wondering why I'm looking over here a lot. And the intro, it says woman moaning, and then we heard some of the sounds, and then it said if these walls could talk, and he ends that part by saying just sex, and then gets into it. Instantly I heard that, I read that part, and I was thinking, shit, he might be talking about pussy, bro. But let's just see, bro. Because I mentioned what I mentioned earlier. But I think he's talking about pussy, bro. I can't lie. I think he's talking about pussy right here. No boat float better than he will. No life jacket, I'm not the guard of Nazareth. But your flood can be misunderstood. Mar telling me that for the pain was singing. He's the one that living, I'm just a relief pigeon. Me, I'm just a minute. Hello, said D wall vacant more than a minute. D wall of vulnerable. Exclamation, interior your pink.
Now I think he's talking about the walls
of like the hood. Now I think he's okay. Maybe, yeah. So maybe that first part was just talking about pussy, bro. Maybe that first part was just talking about pussy, because now I think for sure he's talking about, he's definitely talking about what I thought the walls was referring to. All right, talk to me, Kendrick. Homies to say you're reputable, not acceptable. Your behavior is having the boy like a killer that turns snitch. Walls is telling me you're a bitch. Pray for P.O.S. open the water and water for them. This is
shit is so important.
Walls telling you to listen and sing about me. Retaliation strong, you even dream about me. Kill my homeboy and God spared your life. Dumb criminal got indicted, same night. So when you play the song, rewind the first verse. About me, abusing my power so you can hurt. About me, her in the shower whenever she on it. About me, her at the hours of the morning. About her baby daddy coming to serve her life. And how she think about you until we meet up at night. About the only girl who cared about you when you asked her. And how she fucking on a famous rapper.
Walls can talk, talk.
Remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. Sometimes I did the same, abusing my power full of resentment. Resentment that turned into a deep depression. Found myself screaming in the hotel room.
And then he starts the next track, track six, which is called You. He starts by shit, by screaming. Bro, I really need to get fucking Spotify, bro. I gotta get Spotify, Apple Music or something. Like, for these album reactions, so we can just do the transition smoother. Because this should be dragging me, bro. This should be jarring me. How the transitions are just not smooth on YouTube at all. But yeah, okay. We had that track, These Walls, where he was talking about walls. It seemed like in two different lights as well. In one more sexual manner. And in another more to the theme, talking about the hood. I think he was actually talking about prison walls in particular. But yeah, These Walls nonetheless ends that track by saying me screaming in my hotel room, and now we here. Track six is called You. Intros with them screaming. So this is like inside of his mind. Loving you is complicated. I don't know what he's talking about. I don't know if he's talking about himself or if he's talking about, we're going to go back and read it. But I mean, notice how he mentioned at the beginning, how he's in his hotel room and obviously he's going through the shit that he's going through right now. And then right now we're in this interlude where like there's a whole bunch of these eerie sounds, which if he is talking about himself right now, I imagine these sounds as well are just shit that's going on in his mind, like him getting stressed out and shit. And in the background, I don't know if y'all can hear it through my speakers, but in the background, you can hear the housekeeping people outside of his hotel room knocking, talking about housekeeping, speaking in Spanish or whatever. But like, just to paint the picture, like that he's really in a hotel. That shit is tough. Yeah, housekeeping.
Baby, baby, you the reason why mama and I'm leaving. No, you ain't shit, you say you love him, I know you don't mean it. I know you irresponsible, selfish, you deny you can't help it. Your trials and tribulations are burning, everyone felt it, everyone heard it. Multiple shots, corners, crying, now you are deserted. Where was your antennas again? Where was your presence? Where was your support that you pretend? You ain't no brother, you ain't no disciple, you ain't no friend. A friend never leave confident for profit, only his best friend. Little brother, you promised you watch him. Before this shot, where was your antennas? On the road, bottles and bitches.
I think he is talking about himself. I think he is talking about himself. You ain't no brother, you ain't no disciple, you ain't no friend. A friend never leave Compton for profit. Yeah, okay, survival's guilt. Yeah, he's the one who got out, he's the one who survived. But what about the people who is still there? Oh my God, that's crazy. Okay, I gotta go back. I'm gonna let the song play through, but I'm gonna go back to that first verse now. So this is him talking about himself. He's just in a very stressed out, negative state of mind right now. He's reflecting on his life. Yeah, I made it out. Yeah, I'm viewed as the butterfly now. Yeah, I'm in this limelight perspective, but what about my people back home? Shit, you promised you was gonna watch over your best friend's little brother before they shot him. Hold on.
No, you ain't shit. You say you love him. I know you don't mean it. I know you irresponsible, selfish. You deny you can't help it. Your trials and tribulations are burning. Everyone felt it. Everyone heard it. Multiple shots, corners crying. Now you are deserted. Where was your antennas again? Where was your presence? Where was your support that you pretend? You ain't no brother. You ain't no disciple. You ain't no friend. A friend never leave confident for profit. Only his best friend, little brother. You promised you watch him.
Before they shot him.
Where was your antennas? On the road, bottles and bitches. You FaceTime the one time that's unforgiving. You even FaceTime instead of a hospital visit. Guess you thought he'd recover well. Third surgery, they couldn't stop the bleeding for real. Then he died, God himself would say you fucking failed.
Jeez.
You ain't tried.
Damn. Got too caught up in his rap life, bro. That's crazy. The same little brother of his friend who he said he promised, I'm gonna watch over you forever. Kendrick done got too caught up in the spotlight as a butterfly. He done got too caught up in that rap life. He ain't even go and visit for real. When the kid was in the hospital, he didn't even go visit. He just FaceTiming and thought that was good enough. Because he felt like he was going to recover. But I wonder, I mean, shit, we can't really get inside of his thoughts, but I wonder, is that really what he felt? Or is it just like, let's keep conversation, at least I did my part to keep in touch to make sure he's good. He's speaking to me, so it seemed like he's good. All right, bet, let me get back to my business. On like some neglecting type of time. Third surgery, they couldn't stop the bleeding for real. Then he died, God himself say you fucking failed. You ain't tried. Crazy.
Moose wings is frequent, nigga. I know depression is resting on your arm for two reasons, nigga. I know you and a couple black boys ain't been speaking, nigga. Y'all damn near beefing, I see it, and you're the reason, nigga. And if this bottle could talk, I cry myself to sleep, bitch. Everything is your fault. Falls break into pieces. Earthquakes on every weekend. Because you shook as soon as you knew confinement was needed.
Hold on, that's tough, bro. He said faults breaking to pieces, earthquakes on every weekend. I don't know exactly what part it is, but I know in the science of an earthquake, like the Richter or something, the way that the earthquake is, it cuts the terrain is called a fault. Something about that is called a fault. Someone who knows what I'm talking about knows, but a fault is like a term for like earth, like the science of an earthquake. And then he said faults breaking to pieces, and an earthquake, I mean, shit, breaks shit to pieces. Earthquakes on every weekend. That's tough, bro.
Because you shook. Woo-hoo.
secrets. The world and no one can't stop us, suicidal weakness.
That's crazy. So this is a very personal track. Kendrick kind of talking about, I guess, although he's in the butterfly spotlight, it's not just ups just because you're there. Especially since he mentioned before that his boys look at him like God. Like the boys who is his boys who is still in the bottom, who's still at the bottom, look at him being at the top, like, yo, this guy made it. Nothing can go wrong for him anymore. He escaped the hood. He's got the money, the fame, everything. Meanwhile, you got Kendrick over here in the hotel room going through it, bro. Shit, bro. I really love how he makes this, like, almost like a movie. He makes the track very cinematic in a sense. Not through the sound, but just through his articulating in the song. Like, him doing the gulping sounds of him just drinking liquor. Because obviously he's in a depressed state right now. And he really does a good job in expressing that. Like, even with the way his voice was breaking up, like he's crying. You know, the sniffling in between, the housekeeping, and the sounds in his mind. You know, when your mind is spinning, you're not really hearing it. You're kind of tuning out the environment. And it gives that feeling with the housekeeping part. That shit was tough, bro. And then I guess it makes sense why the track is called You. Shit, bro. I was thinking... See, I be always trying to reach and shit when it comes to Kendrick, bro. But you gotta excuse me, bro. It's fucking Kendrick. I was thinking him calling the track "You," and not even really, you know how you write certain words. You write words formally, of course. Like if you write "you" formally, it's YOW, and you would start a word with a capital letter. But he just wrote "you" as "you" in a very informal manner, and as a lowercase "u" as well. And I wonder if it's just like he's talking about himself in a very demeaning perspective. That might be me completely reaching, but I feel like he put the "u" as a lowercase "u" because of that, bro. I feel like if he was talking about himself in a high perspective, in a king perspective, in a perspective of him being on top, maybe you would have put the "u" in a capital letter, or you would have put it formally as like "u," like self-reflecting. But that might be a reach. Y'all can let me know if it is or not. Okay, track 7. Probably one of the biggest Kendrick Lamar songs on the planet, bro. All Right, featuring Pharrell Williams. Let's get into it. Oh my God.
All's my life I has to fight, nigga.
Jeez.
All's my life I, hard times like, yeah. Bad trips like, yeah. Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up. But
if God got us, then we gon' be all
right. We gon' be all right.
Talk.
We gon' be all right. We gon' be all
right. Hold on, I'm sorry, bro. I got a vibe to this one. We gon' catch the bars. We gon' catch the bars, but hold on.
I got a vibe to this shit. Hold on. This shit is crazy, right? This is a legendary track right here, bro.
Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up, but if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
Nigga, we gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright.
Yeah.
We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. But I'ma still be looking at you from the face down.
I'm going back one more time. We're breaking this shit down now. Let's go. Let's go.
It's my life I had to fight. It's my life I. Hard times like, yeah. Bad trips like, yeah. Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie. You fucked up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be all, yeah. Nigga, we gon' be alright.
Yeah.
We gon' be alright.
Yeah.
Nigga, we gon' be alright.
Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be all
right. And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. But I'ma still be looking at you from the face down. One Mac 11 need the room with the bass down. Skimming. Now let me tell you about my life.
Yeah.
Pain killers only put me in the twilight. Mm. Pretty pussy and Benjamin is the highlight.
Mm.
I tell my mama I love her, but that's what I like. Lord knows. 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me. Reaping everything I sold. So my karma come in heaven.
Yeah.
No preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a motherfucking gangster. Silence for the record.
Yeah.
Tell the world I know it's too late.
be alright. Talk.
Let me be, you feel me? What you want? You a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy.
Oh shit, he kind of had the same scheme on Wesley's theory. This what you want? You want a house or a car, 40 acres and a mule? Hold on. He had the same type of scheme on Wesley's theory too.
What you want? You a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy. You're a dog. Motherfucker, you can live at the mall.
Yeah, literally.
I can tell it. I know it's illegal. I don't think about it. I deposit every year to zero. Thinking of my partner. Put the candy, paint it over Rico. Digging in my pocket. And a profit. Big enough to feed you. Everything my logic. Get another dollar just to keep you in the presence of your Chico. Ah! I don't talk about it. Be a body. If I got it, then you know you got it. Heaven, I can reach you. Pet dog, pet dog, pet dog, my dog, that's all. Pit back and chat. I shut the back for y'all. I rap, I black on tracks. Arrest, assure my rights, my wrongs. I'm right till I'm right. We're calling you. Been down before, nigga. When our pride was low, looking at the world like, where do we go, nigga?
I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. Sometimes I did the same, abusing my power full of resentment. Resentment that turned into a deep depression. Found myself screaming in the hotel room. I didn't want to self-destruct. The evils of Lucy was all around me. So I went running for answers.
Okay, so with this track, I mean, aside from the, hold on, bro. Aside from the legendary presence, bro, give it up one time for this track right here. But on a serious note, I feel like, recall in the artwork, we had that judge who was laying dead on the floor. And then, of course, you had Kendrick and his homies in front of the White House, you know, pretty much partying on some shit like, y'all can't do shit to us. We up, bro. We got the money and shit, bro. We up. Y'all ain't fucking with us no more. The law ain't fucking with us no more. You feel me? I'm tying that to the synopsis because Kendrick had mentioned, no matter how the elites view us, no matter how the people in power view us, no matter how the judges view us, the men who hold the gavel view us, the only one who can truly judge us is God. And God, the Most High. The Most High is the only one who can judge us, and that's it. And I think that's really what he was tapping into with this track. Like, even with the chorus, keeps coming back to him saying, he's at the preacher's door, his knees getting weak, and my gun might blow, but we gonna be all right. And then, yeah, he mentioned praying to God, and yeah, I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up, but if God got us, then we gonna be all right. Like, no matter what we going through in the situation, God gonna have our back. Even if these people who have the power to help us is not gonna help us, even if these people are gonna speak to us and view us with a racial motivation or with a racist motivation, God got our back. The Most High got our back, and the Most High have more power than all of these people combined. So we gonna be all right, you feel me? And I feel like really that's what he's tapping into with this track, which is so tough, bro. I never realized how fluid Kendrick's rapping performance was on this track. I'm sure I've heard it. I mean, no, I'm not going to say I'm sure I've heard it. Of course I've heard it. Everyone's fucking heard this song a million times. But I've never sat down and actually listened to these tracks, like, properly. I've never really added these to the playlist or anything, or just, you know what I'm saying? So I never really listened to the whole track. Yeah, bro, Kendrick's performance on that track was really fluid. He was rapping fast, taking not too many breaths, and he was going at that shit for a while, bro. I didn't realize he was going so fluid on that shit, but yeah, that shit was tough, bro. All right, we got an interlude next. Track 8 is called For Sale. 5-minute interlude, goddamn. Heavy ass breathing.
What's wrong, nigga? I thought you was keeping it gangster. I thought this was what you wanted. I don't know what I get you. I'm gonna go ahead and buy what you can smoke.
bringing up Shireen again. I think he's mentioning Lucy. And let me see. Is he talking about... Okay, I thought he was talking about Lucifer. I thought he was tying it to the devil. Yeah, I was going to say that, like... Because we remember from the last album, Shireen set him up pretty much. And so he thought he was in love with Shireen. And he thought Shireen was a good girl. Went to go meet him. Went to go meet her. And ended up seeing two men in black hoodies who jumped him. And then, yeah, you know what I'm saying? So he looked at Shireen in a whole different light. And thought Shireen was the worst that it can get. But he said... Shireen ain't got nothing on Lucy in this track. You look in my eye about 4 or 5 times till I'm sure to die, you gonna find that. Oh no, never mind. Okay, that's where I saw it. I guess, yeah, I did see that shit. It says here, in that part, that first part of the first verse, Lucy is referring to Lucifer, embodying what Kendrick is claiming the negative aspects are of hip hop, namely the bling cultural, the material shit. I was thinking that because he mentioned in the chorus or in that intro part, or not him, I guess Bilal did, but yeah, they said, if you're scared, go to church, but remember, he knows the Bible too. And he's talking about church, which is referring to God, but obviously he's saying he knows the Bible too. So he is not referring to God, because obviously God knows the Bible, but he knows the Bible too. I assume that was referring to the devil or Lucifer or Satan or however you want to refer to the devil as. But yeah, Shireen ain't got nothing on Lucy. Shireen might seem like a devilish woman, but she got nothing on the real devil though. Like, hold on, wait, okay, wait, slow down. So if he's talking about the devil in this track, what's for sale? Because the track is called For Sale. What's for sale here, bro? Hey, don't sell your soul, Kendrick. Don't sell your soul. Rule number one, mama said, don't sell your soul, son. No matter how far you go, don't sell your soul. Sorry to pause again, but I just wanted to mention that he had the chorus just talking about smoking, low-key, poking that dojo while I'm idle with you. And then that first chorus he mentioned about sipping that potion. Whether that's referring to alcohol or lean. I mean, probably referring to alcohol. But anyways, drugs being a vice. Drugs being something that's tied to the devil in religious viewpoints. I just wanted to point that out. I feel like that's intentional. You said to me, I know what you said to. You said, my name is Lucy Kendrick. You introduced me, Kendrick. Usually I don't do this, but I see you on me, Kendrick. Lucy give you no worries. Lucy got million stories about these rappers that I came after when they was boring. That's so tough. Oh my God. This shit is tough, bro. I'm gonna say this now. Fuck it. I'm gonna say it, bro. After 8 tracks of listening, I can already tell you comfortably this album is better than Section 80. Not so comfortably, but I'm still gonna tell you that this album is better than Good Kid, Mad City. Good Kid, Mad City was a good album, bro. The structure, how every track transitions into the next. It was a very complete, immersive body of work. But this project right here, I mean, this project is also, it's feeling like every track is connecting to the next as well. And it's just like, it's small things. Like with this poem, I just noticed, because I was thinking to myself, like, bro, how many times is he going to bring this poem back? But he's adding a line every time. Every track, where he comes to the end of the track and he's adding a line. It's not even just he's adding a line. The last line seems to relate to the particular track. This track, For Sale, was talking about Lucy, referring to Lucifer, referring to the devil. How Kendrick is pretty much, I'm guessing it's supposed to be him selling his soul. It's referred to him selling his soul, given the For Sale ? Title. And yeah, pretty much him just investing himself into all this material shit now that he's got the money, now that he's up, right? And the end of the poem goes, or at least for this track, the end of the poem goes, the evils of Lucy was all around me, so I went running for answers until I came home. Until I came home and signed this contract and did what I did. The track before that, which was All Right, was the evils of Lucy was all around me, so I went running for answers. And All Right was the track where he went to the church, or when he was looking to God for help. You go to You, and then the track would end. Found myself screaming in a hotel room. I didn't want to self-destruct. The evils of Lucy was all around me, and it ended there. And then it's like, bro, like, he's bringing it back every track, but he's adding a new line. And the last line that he's adding is in relation to the track. But at the same time, it fits with the poem. It's like, bro, that shit is insane, bro. Aside from that, it's just like the subject matter, how consistent he is with the theme. Although he's consistent with the theme in pretty much all of his projects, but just to a deeper extent with this project so far. And like the way it's also the way he's painting the light. Like, he's always been doing the double theme, but he's doing it in a way now where he's not necessarily taking away from the art and the depth and the creativity of it, but he's making it so it's like a little bit more, you don't have to read into it too much to try and understand it. You can kind of just listen to the music and get what he's saying. And that's going to be really good for a listener who's trying to just listen to the album for the music, not really for like an analysis purposes like what we're doing right now. They're still going to be able to catch that double theme, catch all these little deeper meanings. It's crazy, bro. The way that Kendrick fucking scriptures this art, scriptures his music, is so crazy, bro. It's one of a kind shit, bro. I'm so serious, bro. Pray to God that we see another artist like him, but I don't know if we ever will, man. Because it's really like, it's really wild, like the shit that he be doing, bro. It's really crazy. If you really take some time and actually analyze it and observe it, the shit that he be doing on these albums, and for him to do it every single album, it's like, yo, bro, this man deserves all the flowers he gets, bro. It's really crazy. But all right, enough rambling. Let's move on now. Track 9 is called Mama. Mama!
This feeling is unmatched. This feeling is brought to you by adrenaline and good rap. Black penitent ball cap. West. We don't share the same synonym. Far back. West. Been in it before internet had new acts. Mimicking radios, nemesis may be whack. My innocence limited, the experience lacked. 10 of us with no tentative tactic that cracked. The mind of a literate writer, but I did it in fact. You admitted it once I submitted it, wrapped in plastic. Remember scribbling, scratching, diligent sentences backwards, visiting freestyle ciphers for your reaction.
Yeah.
Now I can live in a stadium pack at the fastest. Gambling Benjamin benefits, sending in traffic, spinning women in cartwheels, linen fabric on fashion, winning in every decision. Kendrick gets mastered and mastered it, isn't it? Lovely how menaces turn attraction, pivoting rappers, finish a fraction while writing.
Oh my god.
Thank God for rap.
I'm sorry, bro. That scheme right there, that rhyme scheme right there was ridiculous, bro. Remember scribbling, scratching, diligent sentences backwards, visiting freestyle ciphers for your reaction. Now I can live in a stadium, pack it the fastest, gambling Benjamin benefits, sitting in traffic, spinning in women in cartwheels, linen fabric on fashion, winning in every decision. Kendrick is a master that mastered it. Isn't it lovely how, bro, like the whole fucking verse, pivoting rappers, finish your fraction. Oh my goodness, bro. Oh my goodness, run it back, bro. Run it back, DJ. Run it back. Hold on, he said while riding Blue Magic? Wait, is he talking about the Blue Bills? What is Blue Magic? Because I know Black Magic. What is Blue Magic?
I know everything. Know myself. I know morality, spirituality, good and bad health. I know fatality, my haunter. I know everything. I know Compton. I know street shit. I know shit that's conscious. I know everything. I know lawyers, advertisement, and sponsors. I know wisdom. I know bad religion. I know good karma. I know everything. I know history. I know the universe works mentally. I know the perks of bullshit. Is it meant for me? I know everything. I know cars, clothes, hoes, and money. I know loyalty. I know respect. I know those that's on me. I know everything. The highs, the lows, the groupies, the junkies. I know if I'm generous at heart, I don't need recognition. The way I'm rewarded, well, that's God's decision. I know you know the lines for Compton School District. Just give it to the kids. Don't gossip about how it's distributed.
We've been waiting for you.
Nappy info, gap in a smile. Hand me down sneakers, bounce through the crowd. Run the number, home men and women that crossed him. Sun beaming on his feet, he's exhausted. Tossing footballs with his ashy black ankles. Breaking new laws, mama passed on home training. You look at me and say, Kendrick, you do know my language. You just forgot because of what public schools had painted. Oh, I forgot, don't kill my vibe, that's right, you're famous. I used to watch on Channel 5, TV was taken. But never mind, you're here right now, don't you mistake it, it's just a new trip. Take a glimpse of your family ancestor, make a new list of everything you thought was progress and that was bullshit. I know your life is full of turmoil and spoil, but fantasies of who you are, I feel bad for you. If you pick destiny, hope for rest in peace, then be an advocate. Tell your homies especially to come back home.
Jeez. Track 10 is called Hood Politics. Let's go. Yeah.
scandalous. So much shit for the ambulance. The project filled with cameras. The LAPD gambling, scrambling. Football numbers slandering. Niggas' names on paper. You snitched all summer. Streets down filming now. They tell me it's a new gang in town. From Compton to Congress. Set tripping all around. Ain't nothing new but a flow. New Democrats and Rep Latigans. Red state versus blue state. Which one you governing?
Oh, wow. That is fire. Oh, wow, that's fire. For him to go from Compton to Congress and then even him slowing it down from Compton to Congress. Like, making it sound like it's the same shit, but it's like, really, hey, new gang in town. He started it from there and then had a gang theme on the government. Compton to Congress. Set tripping all around. Ain't nothing new but a flow of new Democrats. You got Democrats and Republicans. Democrats and Republicans. But literally in the election, the Democrats are represented with the color of blue and the Republicans are represented with the color of red. That's crazy, bro. Red state versus blue state. Which one are you governing? That's crazy. For him to like tie it into the red and blue of the gang life, the red and blue of like the election politic environment. This shit is insane, bro. Holy fuck.
I've been there once since day one, you niggas boo boo. Your own boy, you black that you're from.
Boo boo.
Little hoes you went to school with. Boo boo. Baby mama ain't your new bitch. Boo boo. Critics wanna mention that they missed when hip hop was rapping. Motherfucker, if you did, the kid of Mike could be platinum.
Jeez. Tough. Wow, that's so tough. For him to say, I resolved it inside that private hall while sitting down with Jay. He said, it's funny how one verse can fuck up the game. They came back with the chorus, said, I've been A1 since day one. Y'all boys is boo-boo. One verse, and then he cuts the chorus. That's so tough, bro. Little details, I'm telling you, bro. But if you catch that shit, it makes the song 10 times better.
I resolved inside that private hall while sitting down with Jay. He said, it's funny how one verse can fuck up the game.
One verse. Cut.
I remember you was conflicted.
Oh, in the poem, let's go.
Misusing your influence.
Here we go.
Sometimes I
gotta add some lines now.
Abusing my power, full of resentment.
Right.
Resentment that turned into a deep depression.
Found myself
screaming in the hotel room. I didn't want to self-destruct. The evils of Lucy was all around me. So I went running for answers until I came home.
Yeah.
But that didn't stop survivors.
Yeah, okay, new lines.
Going back and forth, trying to convince myself the stripes I earned.
Right.
Or maybe how A1 my foundation
was. Wow.
And while my loved ones was fighting a continuous war back in the city, I was entering a new one.
But while my loved ones was fighting a continuous war back in the city, I was entering a new one. A new war. Against who? Against the elites, against the police, against the judge. Next track is called How Much a Dollar Cost, so let's see if that ties in. Or a new war with himself, maybe.
How much a dollar really costs?
Right.
The question is detrimental, paralyzed in my thoughts.
Yeah.
In my stomach, keeping woke up, feeling y'all. Yeah. See how I'm chilling once I park this luxury car. Tempo, 20 or pump 6, 20 my sentence, call me Dumbo. 20 years ago, came for kids. Now I can lend them my error too. I just stack these residuals tenfold.
Marcellus called me Dumbo 20 years ago. Can't forget that. Now I can lend him an ear or two. Dumbo, known for the big ears.
Now I can lend them my error too. I just stack these residuals.
residuals tenfold. The liberal concept and mirror through 2006, you didn't hear me. Indigenous African only spoke Zulu, my American tongue was lyric. Walked out the gas station, a homeless man with a 7'10 complexion asked me what team playing, stressing about dry land. Deep water, got blue skies to crack open a piece of crack that he wanted. I knew he was smoking, he banged and beat it. Asked me to feed him twice, I didn't believe it, told him beat it. Contributed money just for his pipe, I couldn't see it. He said, my son, temptation is one thing that I've defeated. Listen to me, I want a single bill from you. Nothing less, never more. I told him, mind me, half of it calls my door. Tell me how much a diamond costs.
Him to see what he was referring to when he's saying the dollar, the value of a dollar, because obviously he's not talking about monetary value, because the value of a dollar is $1. I was wondering if he's gonna get into that, and then he just mentioned it right here. He said, or the man who was staring at him throughout the entire story said, and he mentioned Nazareth again, the nerve of Nazareth, and I'll tell you just how much dollar costs, the price of having a spot in heaven, embrace your loss. So the man was asking for, he's been said In the first couple verses, he was saying, I already have conquered, mastered the indulgence into temptation. I'm not asking you for money out of temptation, out of need for something else. Kendrick was just viewing him like a crackhead, bro. Kendrick just thought he was giving him money. He just wants money so he can go and spend it on drugs anyway. And Kendrick doesn't want to fund that. So he's like, nah, bro, I'm not giving you no money, not even $1. Really? He was asking for $1 to secure Kendrick a spot in heaven. Hey, man. He said, how much a dollar costs? The price of having a spot in heaven. Embrace your loss now. You ain't want to offer me a dollar? Yeah, shit. Go ride in hell, no. Yeah, this shit was crazy, bro. Because, like, again, I'm mentioning in that first verse how the man said, temptation is one thing that I've defeated. Listen to me. I want a single bill from you. Nothing less, nothing more. Kendrick told him, I told him I don't have it and closed my door. And he gave him through the entire duration of the song. He stared at him. He was trying to give him a signal like, hey, man, just give me the dollar, bro. It's your spot in heaven. I'm giving you a chance. And Kendrick just, he wasn't catching the signal. He wasn't seeing it the entire time. I'm curious now because the man mentioned Exodus 14, which I'm assuming is a Bible verse. And I wonder if that has something to do with the whole thing of the whole theme of the track. Okay, wait, Exodus 14 tells the story of Moses parting the Red Sea, God in the scared and confused Israelites to safety. This line is a metaphor describing the power one man can have to lead his people. All we ever need is someone in Kendrick's position to lead by example. It says here that God chose Moses as the great prophesied leader to deliver the Israelites from slavery, which I'm assuming is supposed to be a reference of Kendrick is supposed to be compared to Moses in this case. and the people he's supposed to help or free from the hood is the people, or is the Israelites who are in slavery. You see, bro, Kendrick is different, bro. This motherfucker be doing biblical references and all type of shit, tying it into, bro, he be tying themes into themes, bro. Double themes, bro. Y'all be doing double entendres. This man be doing double themes. This man wrote a rap and tied that shit into the theme of the butterfly caterpillar thing with the Pimp a Butterfly theme, the theme of the album. But that theme is tied to a biblical theme of fucking Moses and the Israelites. Oh my goodness, bro. I was kind of thinking about that too. Not that biblical shit, but like the concept. I was kind of thinking about it like, yo, like Kendrick being the one in power, he has all the money in the world. He should give to the people in his hood. And the man was asking, you know, you never, doing good for people is only really going to do good for yourself. And, you know, you never going to know how far that shit's going to go until you actually go about it, which Kendrick wasn't willing to do. I mean, he just saw what was actually happening in front of his eyes, but he didn't see the principle of the action, you know, given to the people who were in need when he has all the money in the world to give. He chose not to give, and in this case, I guess, it ended up costing him his spot in heaven. But, yeah, that was crazy. That was a tough song. All right, track 12 is called Complexion. This one is featuring Rhapsody. And in brackets, it says Azulu Love.
I'm with this. Complexion. Complexion don't mean
is talking about race, given he said dark as the midnight hour or bright as the morning sun. But yeah, I mean, pretty much talking about fuck the racism shit, bro. Let's come together. He said, bro, I make a flower out of cotton just to chill with you, obviously referring to the whole how slaves had to pick cotton before was like whites dominating over blacks. And now he's making a thing of like, yo, I make the flower out of cotton, pretty much just saying like, Cut the complexion superiority shit. Bro, let's come together, bro. Let's come together.
You know I go the distance. You know I'm 10 toes down, even if that's a listener. Cover your ears, he about to make you complexion. Complexion don't mean a thing. Sun, brown skin, and much of blue eyes. Tell me your mama can't run. Sneak me through the back window. I'm a good film, nigga. I made a flower for you out of cotton just to chill with you. You know I go the distance. You know I'm 10 toes down, even if that's a listener. I got the world attention, so I'ma say something that's vital and critical for survival of mankind. If we not a color, should never rival. Beauty is what you make it. I used to be so mistaken by different shades and faces. That wit told me your woman is woman of the creation. It all came from God, that you was my confirmation. I came to where you reside and looked around and see more sights for sore eyes. Let the will legendary reverse a million times with complexion.
Enforcing my dark side like a young George Lucas? Come on. Star Wars bar. That's up. Young George Lucas.
Teenage gun told us that don't play fair. Should I get out the car? I don't see Compton. I see something much worse. The land of the landmines, the hell that's on earth.
All right, we move now to track 13, which is called The Black and the Berry. So crazy, bro. Let's go. If I'm wrong, but was he trying to do kind of what he was doing with King Kunta and Institutionalize, like similar to how King Kunta was the butterfly perspective and Institutionalize was like the caterpillar perspective? Is Complexion and The Black of the Berry kind of the same thing? Because in Complexion, I mean, he was just got off of Complexion talking about, you know, I don't care about what your complexion is, I don't care about how you look, to now Black of the Berry, he's definitely not on the same type of time he was on Complexion. It must be because, yeah, he starts the first verse of the song by saying, I'm the biggest hypocrite of 2015. Because, yeah, literally, it's not the first time in the album that he did that. In the, like I mentioned, with King Kunta Institutionalized, he spoke about King Kunta in a certain, he spoke about himself and his people in a certain perspective in King Kunta. And then the complete opposite perspective, or the complete, a perspective that completely opposes what he was talking about in King Kunta is what he was talking about in Institutionalized. And now he's kind of doing the same thing with Complexion in this song, The Black and the Berry. Complexion, he was talking about what he was talking about. And in this song, The Black and the Berry, it seems like off the jump, he's already kind of just debunking his own shit. Like, just say on some like, psych, huh? You believe me at first. You thought I was on that type of time. Nah, bro. Yeah, just, I was just talking. That was just music, bro. This is what I'm really feeling. Man said, I'm black as the moon. That's crazy. In the last song, he was talking about dark as midnight and bright as when the sun out, or something like about bright as the sun, right? And now he's here saying, I'm African, I'm black as the moon. When you look at the moon is, it looks white, but it's white only because of the sun's light. You take the sun's light off of it, the moon is completely black. So That's kind of tough, bro. Mm. Say, you see how the whip left scars on my back? Now he got a big whip part pun the block. Come on, bro. Pun the block, bro. A lot of black stereotype he just mentioned. So, or tried to celebrate February like it's my B-Day, February being Black History Month, or eat watermelon chicken or Kool-Aid on weekdays, or jump high enough to get Michael Jordan endorsements, or watch BET, Black Entertainment Television, because urban support is important. Yeah, tough, bro. Not to get distracted from the album, but I mentioned at the beginning before we started getting into this track, I'd mentioned that Drake made a reference to this in Family Matters, and I just noticed that that boy wanted to produce this track. But I could understand why he did mention it, given that Kendrick called him white and said that he isn't. Yeah, I'm not going to get into that, but it makes sense why Drake mentioned this in the Family Matters diss track. But anyways, in terms of the track, yeah, I mean, pretty much it's, he keeps calling himself a hypocrite, which he kind of is based on how the message he was giving in Complexion is completely shat on that message. Pretty much he's like, hey, look, this is how I feel, and then all of a sudden he's like, you know what, fuck that, fuck y'all, this is not how I feel no more, I'm on different type of Tommy. Came on this track on some whole different shit. Track 14 is called You Ain't Gotta Lie, and in brackets, Mama Said.
My neck.
kick in my neck. We ain't gotta lie, we ain't gotta lie, we ain't gotta lie, have to kick in my neck.
Track 6 was talking about, and track 6 was called You. Now we hear track 15, which is called I. So let's see. Maybe this is going to be the good perspective that I was mentioning before. Given that You was like a more depressed, bad perspective.
But I know God, the devil when I call me in a bow tie. Believe that the holy water don't go dry. Yeah, yeah. As I look around me, so many motherfuckers wanna down me. But enemy gonna never drown me. That's all I would dirty double baby to drown me. And I love my
So pretty much he had You, which was a track of him in a depressed, negative state, completely shitting on himself, hating on himself, thinking of himself as a horrible person for leaving his hood, not necessarily leaving his hood behind, but kind of being neglectful of them since he's so absorbed in his butterfly life, his rap star, highly praised perspective. He's so consumed with that that he forgot to be as attentive as he was before, or he should have been, towards his people who is down at the bottom, who ain't at the place where he's at. And now, funny enough, I think he's actually in the hood with those same people that he felt like he was neglecting in You. He's with them in this track on I, after resolving some of his issues. And he's talking about himself in a way more positive, or he's talking about himself in a positive light in general. Completely opposite of what it was like in You. Which is tough. Because also, like, You and I, but like both times he's referring to himself, just again in different perspectives. So
what do you want from me to my skies? Everybody lack confidence. Everybody lack confidence. How many times my potential was anonymous? How many times the city making me promises? So I promise this nigga. I love myself. I'm only looking at me. I tell me what you see. I love myself. I put a bullet in the back of the back of the head and I pull you. I went to war last night. With a automatic weapon, don't nobody call a medic. I'ma do it till I get it right. I went to war last night.
Victim, huh?
Niggas ain't trying to play Vic 2-2. How many niggas we done lost? How many? Yeah, how many we lost? No, for real, answer the question. How many niggas we done lost, bro? This year alone.
Damn.
Exactly, so we ain't got time to waste time, my nigga. Niggas gotta make time, bro. The judge make time. You know that, the judge make time, right?
Crazy.
The judge make time so it ain't shit. It shouldn't be shit for us to come out here and appreciate the little bit of life we got left, dog.
Bro, there could be a double in that too. This man's talk. I'm telling you, bro. This man be the chatting bars, bro. What the fuck? Who do this shit, bro? Like Kendrick. Man said the judge make time. He's talking about making time, like making time, like what it sound like. But the judge make time. I feel like it's more than just making time. I feel like he's talking about time like a sentence too. Like the judge make time as well.
It shouldn't be shit for us to come out here and appreciate the little bit of life we got left, dog. And I say this because I love niggas, man. I love all my niggas, bro.
Real shit.
Enough said. We're gonna get back to the show and move on because that shit petty, my nigga. My check. We're gonna do some acapella shit before we get back to our.
This is tough, bro.
Listen to this. I promised Dave I never used the phrase fuck nigga. He said, think about what you saying. Fuck niggas. No better than Samuel on the Django. No better than a white man with slave boats. Sound like I needed some soul searching. My pops gave me some game in real person. We traced my steps on what they never taught me. Did my homework fast before government caught me. So I'ma dedicate this one verse to Oprah on how the infamous sensitive N-word control us. So many artists gave her an explanation to hold us. Well, this is my explanation, straight from Ethiopia. N-E-G-U-S. Definition, royalty. King, royalty. Wait, listen. N-E-G-U-S. Description, black emperor, king, ruler. Now let me finish. The history books overlooked the word and hide it. America tried to make it to a house divided. The homies don't recognize we've been using it wrong. So I'ma break it down and put my game in a song. N-E-G-U-S. Say it with me, or say no more. Black stars can come and get me. Take it from Oprah Winfrey. Tell her she right on time. Kendrick Lamar, by far, realest niggas alive.
Yeah, again, with the cinematic elements, I love how in that outro, is like everyone was kind of rambling and kind of in their own space. And he took the mic and started just preaching in that outro. And slowly, as he started to get deeper and deeper into the theme of what he was talking about, more people were quieting down and listening to him until he became the forefront of the track. And we got the final track, fucking 12 minutes long, but hey, we here, bro. Mortal Man. I've been anticipating to listen to this track more than any other track on this album. Just again, because I know he speaks about exactly what the theme of To Pimp a Butterfly is. Although I'm pretty sure after listening to everything we've listened to, we can say that we've drilled down the theme, but to the pinpoint exact, Kendrick is going to mention it, I believe, on this track. So let's see what he's talking about, bro. 12 minutes. Fucking hell. Sing About Me, I'm Dying of Thirst, part 2. Let's go. Yeah, strap in for this shit.
If the government want me dead, pack cocaine in my car.
Jesus.
Judge me a drug kid or see me as K Lamar. Question my character and degrade me on every block.
Okay, yeah. So, yeah. So, I mean, he hasn't really per se explained directly what Pimp a Butterfly means, but he's kind of talking about what we was already talking about with the caterpillar versus butterfly, the different lights that you can view. And he's talking about himself, like, how do you view me? How do you as a fan view me? If the government want me dead, plant cocaine in my car, would you judge me as a drug head? One light, the caterpillar light. Or would you see me as K. Lamar, as the superstar, the one who deserves the praise, etc., etc., the butterfly light? Talk to me, Kendrick.
Or see me as K. Lamar. Question my character and degrade me on every block. Want you to love me like Nelson. Want you to hug me like Nelson. I feed you for being a slave in your mind. You're very welcome. You tell me my song is more than a song. It's surely a blessing. But a prophet ain't a prophet till he asks you this question.
When shit hit the fan, is you still a fan?
When shit hit the fan, is you still a fan?
Let's talk.
Won't you look to your left and right? Make sure you ask your friends. When shit hit the fan, is you still a fan? You believe in her. You think she gon' stick around if them 25 years occur? You think he can hold you down when you down beyond bars hurt? You think y'all on common ground if you promise to be the first? Can you be immortalized without your life being expired? Even though y'all share the same blood, is it worth the time? Like, who got your best interest? Like, how much are you dependent? I clutch other people that say they love you and who pretended. How tough is your skin when they turn you in? Do you show forgiveness? What brush do you bend with dust in your shoulders for being offended? What kind of den did they put you in when the lions are hissing? What kind of bridge did they burn with venture? Your mind when it's mentioned. You wanna love like Nelson. You wanna be like Nelson. You wanna walk in his shoes, but your peace making seldom. You wanna be remembered and deliver the message that considered the blessing of everyone. This your lesson for everyone. Say, well, shit hit the fan.
I guess you still a fan. Oh my god.
Shit hit the fan. Is you still a fan? Won't you look to your left and right? Make sure you ask your friends. Well, shit hit the fan. Is you still a fan? The voice of Mandela. Hold this close, they propelling. Let my word be your earth and moon. You consume every message. As I lead this army, make room for mistakes and depression. And if you ride with me, nigga, I've been brought up before. I got abandonment issues. I hold grudges like bad judges. Don't let me resent you. That's not Nelson like. Want you to love me like Nelson. I went to Robbins Island, analyzed it. That's where his cell is. So
I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. Sometimes I did the same.
Oh, yeah, okay. Talk.
Abuse of my power.
The full poem.
Resentment that turned into a deep depression. Found myself screaming in a hotel room. I didn't want to
self-destruct.
The evils of Lucy was all around me. So I went running for answers. Until I came home. But that didn't stop survivor's guilt. Going back and forth trying to convince myself the stripes I earned. Or maybe how A1 my foundation was. But while my loved ones was fighting a continuous war back in the city, I was entering a new one. A war that was based on apartheid and discrimination.
Right.
Made me want to go back to the city and tell the homies what I learned. The word was respect. Just because you wore a different gang color than mine doesn't mean I can't respect you as a black man. Forgetting all the pain and hurt we caused each other in these streets. If I respect you, we unify and stop the enemy from killing us. But I don't know. I'm no mortal man. Maybe I'm just another nigga. Shit, that's all I wrote. I was gonna call it another nigga, but it ain't really a poem. I just felt like it's something you probably could relate to. Other than that, now that I finally got a chance to holler at you, I always wanted to ask you about a certain situation, about a metaphor, actually. You spoke on the ground. What you mean by that? What the ground represent?
The ground is going to open up and swallow the evil.
Right.
That's how I see it. My word is born. I see, and the ground is a symbol for the poor people.
Right.
The poor people is going to open up this whole world and swallow up the rich people. Because the rich people are going to be so fat and they're going to be so appetizing. You know what I'm saying? Wealthy, appetizing. The poor going to be so poor and hungry.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's going to be like, you know what I'm saying? It might be some cannibalism out this month. They might eat the rich. You know what I'm saying?
All right, so let me ask you this then. do you see yourself as somebody that's rich or somebody that made the best of their own opportunities?
I see myself as a natural born hustler, a true hustler in every sense of the word. I took nothing, I took the opportunities.
Oh, shit. Okay, I was just wondering who he's having a conversation with. He's talking to Tupac. Obviously, this is post-Hamas Tupac getting into his mind. Wow, this is cool. Okay,
right. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna be like, you know what I'm saying? There might be some cannibalism out this month. They might eat the rich. You know what I'm saying?
All right, so let me ask you this then. Do you see yourself as somebody that's rich or somebody that made the best of their own opportunities?
I see myself as a natural born hustler, a true hustler in every sense of the word. I took nothing, I took the opportunities. I worked at the most menial and degrading job and built myself up so I can get it to where I owned it. I went from having somebody manage me to me hiring the person that works my management company. Yeah. I changed everything. I realized my destiny in a matter of 5 years, you know what I'm saying? I made myself a millionaire. I made millions for a lot of people. Now it's time to make millions for myself, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
I made millions for the record companies. I made millions for these movie companies. Now I'm making millions for us.
And through your different avenues of success, how would you say you manage to keep a level of sanity?
By my faith in God, by my faith in the game, and by my faith in all good things come to those that stay true.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And it was happening to me for a reason. You know what I'm saying? I was noticing shit. I was punching the right buttons and it was happening. So it's no problem. You know, I mean, it's a problem, but I'm not going to let them know. I'm going to go straight through.
Would you consider yourself a fighter at heart or somebody that only reacts when their back is against the wall?
Shit, I like to think that in every opportunity I've ever been threatened with resistance, it's been met with resistance. And not only me, but it goes down my family tree. You know what I'm saying? It's in my veins to fight back.
How long do you think it take before niggas be like, we fight the war, I'm fighting the war, I can't win, and I want to lay it all down?
In this country, a black man only have like 5 years we can exhibit maximum strength. And that's right now, while you're a teenager, while you're still strong, while you still want to lift weights, while you still want to shoot back. Because once you turn 30, it's like they take the heart and soul out of a man, out of a black man in this country. And you don't want to fight them.
Damn.
And if you don't believe me, you can look around. You don't see no loudmouth 30-year-old motherfuckers.
That's crazy. Because me being one of your offsprings of the legacy you left behind, I can truly tell you that it's nothing but turmoil going on. So I wanted to ask you, what you think is the future for me and my generation today?
I think that niggas is tired of grabbing shit out the stores, and next time it's a riot, it's gonna be like bloodshed, for real. I don't think America know that. I think America think we was just playing, it's gonna be some more playing, but it ain't gonna be no playing. It's gonna be murder. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna be like Nat Turner, 1831, up in this motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna happen.
In my opinion, only hope that we kind of have left is music and vibrations. A lot of people don't understand how important it is. You know, sometimes I can like get behind a mic and I don't know what type of energy I'm gonna push out or where it comes from. It trip me out sometimes.
That's the spirit. We ain't even really rapping. We just letting our dead homies tell stories for us.
Which is crazy because he's talking to Tupac right now. Him talking to Tupac, and then Tupac being the one who says, because it's spirits, we ain't even really rapping. Kendrick just mentioned he doesn't know where the energy comes from or where the voice or the ideas come from that he puts into his raps. It just comes to him and he just spit it out. And Tupac mentions it's because of, it comes from the spirits. It comes from the ones before us, but Tupac himself being the spirit before Kendrick.
I wanted to read one last thing to you.
All right, and then here's where he's going to talk about that Pimp a Butterfly. He's gonna talk about the meaning of the album, what I was looking for. By the way, if you're wondering why the setup looks different, why I look different than I did just 10 seconds ago, the camera died, the footage died, so I'm just re-recording this part of the video. Just didn't include it because I didn't want to miss out on it. This is a pretty crucial part of the album.
The caterpillar is a prisoner to the streets that conceived it.
Right.
Its only job is to eat or consume everything around it.
Right.
In order to protect itself from this mad city. While consuming this environment, the caterpillar begins to notice ways to...
Small thing, but I like him referring to his city as the mad city, just kind of playing on his previous album, how he was referring to his area before.
Its only job is to eat or consume everything around it in order to protect itself from this mad city. While consuming this environment, the caterpillar begins to notice ways to survive. One thing it notices is how much the world shuns them, but praises the butterfly. The butterfly represents the talent, the thoughtfulness, and the beauty within the caterpillar. But having a harsh outlook on life, the caterpillar sees the butterfly as weak and figures out a way to pimp it to its own benefits. Already surrounded by this mad city, the caterpillar goes to work on the cocoon, which institutionalizes him. He can no longer see past his own thoughts. He's trapped.
Also notice, I'm going to go back to it when we're done with this last little monologue, but notice how as he's describing To Pimp a Butterfly, he's describing it in chronology of each track in the album. I'm going to go back and expand on that a little bit further, but just pay attention to that.
Way to pimp it to his own benefits. Already surrounded by this mad city, the caterpillar goes to work on the cocoon,
right?
Institutionalizes
him.
He can no longer see past his own thoughts. He's trapped. While trapped inside these walls, certain ideas take root, such as going home and bringing back new concepts to this mad city. The result? Wings begin to emerge, breaking the cycle of feeling
stagnant.
Finally free, the butterfly sheds light on situations that the caterpillar never considered, ending an internal struggle. Although the butterfly and caterpillar are completely different,
they're one and the same. Damn.
What's your perspective on that?
Defining To Pimp a Butterfly, he says, the caterpillar is a prisoner to the streets that conceived it. Its only job is to eat or consume everything around it in order to protect itself from its mess, from this mad city. Kind of is the perspective he was having pretty much up until institutionalized in Wesley's Theory for Free and King Kunta with the whole tax evasion, save my money. The caterpillar starts to notice ways to survive. One thing it notices is how much the world shuns him but praises the butterfly, which he talks about in King Kunta. The butterfly represents the talent, the thoughtfulness, and the beauty within the caterpillar. Having an harsh outlook on life, the caterpillar sees the butterfly as weak and figures out ways to pimp it to its own benefits. Already surrounded by this mad city, the caterpillar goes to work on the cocoon which institutionalizes him, which he talks about in the song Institutionalized, as well as these walls. I believe he was tapping into that as well. And even with what he was saying about the caterpillar sees the butterfly as weak and having a harsh outlook on life, those lines kind of tap towards you, the track You. On the part where he says the caterpillar begins to notice ways to survive, kind of taps into the whole institutionalized part or institutionalized track. And then past the part where he says the caterpillar goes to work on the cocoon, which institutionalizes him, he can no longer see past his own thoughts. He's trapped. When trapped inside these walls, which of course is these walls is the next track after institutionalized, certain ideas take root, such as going home and bringing back new concepts to this mad city. He starts to bring those concepts in All Right and even in For Sale. I feel like he started to talk about that type of the concept that he felt like he was learning. Wings begin to emerge, breaking the cycle of feeling stagnant, finally free. The butterfly sheds light on situations the caterpillar never considered. I feel like that part is talking about past how much a dollar costs. I guess when he's saying, when trapped inside these walls, certain ideas take root, such as going home and bringing back new concepts to this mad city. I think that part is actually talking about all the way up until how much a dollar costs. So really, All Right, For Sale, Mama, Hood Politics, How Much a Dollar Costs is kind of covered by that section. And then when he starts to say the wings begin to emerge, the cycle, breaking the cycle of feeling stagnant, the butterfly sheds light on situations the caterpillar never considered, that's more towards the You Ain't Gotta Lie track, the Complexion track, kind of Black of the Berry, but really Complexion and You Ain't Gotta Lie, I feel like, or tracks like that. And especially even on I, he was literally amongst his community and he was shedding light on perspectives or ideas he learned through his own experience of being where he's at and seeing perspectives that the people who haven't reached this position didn't get a chance to see. He finalizes by saying, although the butterfly and the caterpillar are completely different, they're one and the same. Pretty much just talking about evolution. I mean, even the ones who are viewed as the caterpillar, what we've been saying this entire time, have that butterfly in them. They have those perspectives that Kendrick is viewed to have. Everyone has those in them. They're all the same. It's just where they come from and external factors that don't really, that shouldn't apply to how you judge the character. But external factors nonetheless is the reason why they're being judged so differently. And although they appear as two different things, the caterpillar and the butterfly, they're one and the same. They are the same thing. You just need to give the caterpillar time to evolve into the butterfly. You need to give it time to come out of the cocoon, and you're going to really see they're all really the same. This album was definitely my favorite album out of everything I've heard. I'm very excited to go back and listen to Damn, because I probably would have said up until this point that Damn is my favorite album I've heard from Kendrick Lamar. But now I got to go back and listen to it, because this album was incredible, bro. I think it fully deserves the praise that it has as one of the greatest albums of all time when it comes to hip hop. Like, from the small details of, man, I'm so amazed in the way that Kendrick did that poem, bro. The way he instilled that poem line by line into every track, but made it make sense with it, with the chronology of the story. And even to be able to do it, like, to where each line is like the perfect place to stop for a certain track, and then the way you could tie everything back to the original meaning. And then with this track, Mortal Man, it kind of, all the questions you may have had up until track 15 get all answered in this little conversation he has with Tupac. I might have to get a vinyl, bro. I've been starting to build up my vinyl wall a little bit, and I might have to get a Pimp a Butterfly vinyl, bro. Let's go over the track list just one more time. We have Wesley's Theory, where he came in talking about tax evasion, and the perspective was very much so of a caterpillar, or what was painted in the light of as a caterpillar, that, you know, entrapped perspective that doesn't come outside of the hood, or the perspective that's viewed very negatively. Wesley's Theory was definitely reflective of that. For Free was kind of emphasizing that caterpillar perspective as even some more. Because it's like Kendrick rebuttaling what America is telling him on Wesley's Theory, or what America is doing to him on Wesley's Theory. Then you had King Kunta, which was, I think Kendrick himself still had that caterpillar perspective, but that's where you can start to differentiate as a listener the two different perspectives, the butterfly and the caterpillar, the king and the Kunta perspective. Then you had Institutionalized. Like, the first four tracks really were painting Kendrick in having the caterpillar mind, I guess. The caterpillar mindset. King Kunta was really the only track that, I guess, cemented him as, like, the butterfly. Or was really the track where you started to divide those two perspectives. But from Wesley's Theory to Institutionalized, it's definitely, like, caterpillar perspective. And then you have These Walls, which is where, again, you see some sort of, that's where you start to see a bit of a division. And then from You is like the self-reflection track, where he's starting to realize, like you got to change. He's got to change the way he's looking at things. That's when he starts to develop new perspectives, like what he was saying at the end of this little monologue here. That's when he started to, when you're in the cocoon, where you're in those walls, in You, he was literally, he was in a hotel room, but he was literally entrapped within the walls of the hotel room. So it's kind of funny how, like, the way he's saying the caterpillar is entrapped within these walls of the cocoon and emerges with new perspectives. The hotel room, although it was kind of painted as that cocoon in the chronology of Kendrick's story. So again, from Wesley's Theory to These Walls is really like the caterpillar perspective. And that's where the division starts to happen. And then track on You is, you could almost say it's like the cocoon track, or like the cocoon perspective, if you want to say it like that. When he's in the walls and he's starting to develop those new perspectives, those new ways to look at things. And then from All Right, For Sale, Mamahood Politics, How Much a Dollar Costs, he's kind of going through experiences that develop him even more as a butterfly. Complexion, again, I'm realizing, hey, there ain't just one superior race and one lower. All races is equal. Black and the Berry, he kind of has a bit of a rebuttal. And then You Ain't Got a Lie. Like, slowly he starts to, you can see his evolution literally through the track list too. Like, of him going through his real life evolution from a caterpillar to a butterfly. And then, yeah, and then by the time he gets to I, he's like completely developed the butterfly perspective to its fullest. And then you have Mortal Man, where he reflects on it all. But then you could also look at each track individually with its own, with two different perspectives of the caterpillar and the butterfly. So it's just, I'm telling you, bro, it's just the completion, the cohesion, you know, the chronology of the project is just, it's just wonderful, bro. Again, I'm very excited to hear Damn. And I haven't, honestly, I haven't heard Mr. Morale and the Big Step is properly. I've heard it completely through at least once when the album came out. But since then, I haven't really heard it too much. And I feel like that album is going to be a very thematic album like this one. So I'm curious to see what he's going to be talking about on that one. But yeah, I'm going to be taking this shit with me, bro. I'm going to be taking this album and be listening to it for the next couple months probably. Just catching new themes. Yeah, hopefully y'all enjoyed this video. If you did, you know what to do. And I'm going to catch y'all in the next one.